Hello, well, I feel as if I should burst into song with the guest that I have for lunchtime today. It's Barry Sinclair, who will be bringing us the magic of Ivor Novello at a concert at the Festival Hall on the 1st of March, Barry.
Yes, 1st of March.
And it's lovely to see you again. And what I wanted to know was how you and Ivor Novello very first got together. Well, when you first took over, in fact, some of the parts.
Well, it's an awful long time ago. You see, I was playing in London, I was a straight actor. I was young and I was successful and I was playing people who shot their wives, put them in boxes and then got worried about it. Stupid, really. If you put them in boxes, that's good. Anyhow, during this time, you see, Ivor Novello's first musical play, it was A Glamorous Night, at Theatre Royal Drury Lane. What about that title? Theatre Royal Drury Lane. Ah. Anyhow, that was coming to an end and going on tour. They were looking for a man to play his part and they couldn't find one. It seems most unlikely. And they searched and searched and it got to such a state that eventually the touring company opened for 3 weeks at Streatham Hill and Ivor had to play with them because they hadn't found anybody. So then they put out an enormous call for it. They lighted on me and I said, no, thank you. Not thank you very much. I'm doing very nicely in the West End of London. I'm very successful. I do a tour in a musical.
It's a dirty word, was it?
Oh, yes. I mean, tour, you know, you go on tour and it was the end in those days. You didn't want to do it at all. Force to tour, tour de force. I mean, they're interchangeable. And anyhow, eventually an agent said to me, well, listen, it might be politic if you were to take this part and do a short tour because it might lead to a little more work. You never know.
How much work did it lead to, Barry?
16 years.
16 and it all years. Began with that play.
It all began The Glamorous Night, which I then toured for about 18 months and revived the Colosseum and so on.
And you played Rudy then, didn't you?
No, that was not Rudy. That was Anthony Allen, Glamorous Night.
Ah, yes. I'm getting my
titles mixed
up. Or they
call it in Wales Glamorgan Nights, you know?
Oh, yes.
And in Bradford, Gormless Night, it didn't go on forever.
Tell me, what was Ivor Novello really like? Because his music today makes him seem a little bit more insipid, I suppose, than he probably really was.
Oh, no, no, no. But, of course, it's a long time ago, and you are extremely young.
And you're extremely charming.
No, well, he was oddly enough, you could talk about an hour about him. He was the most unusual person I've ever met. He had about 8 different compartments to his brain. They all worked independently. He could switch them on one after the other. Charming, sweet, generous, open-minded, open-handed, unscrupulous, business-like, hard as nails. They switched on one after the other, and they were all perfectly genuine, as far as I could see.
He gave you that ring, didn't he?
Yes. Well, actually, there's a story attached to this because we eventually became very great friends, you know. And I used to pull his leg unmercifully. He used to get very bored with playing
circus
for a long time.
There it is. Yes, I can see it now.
Oh, yes. I wonder if you can just catch that. Yes, there. And you'll see, if you look very carefully, it's got a double S scribbled on it. Well, that's his scribble, you see. And I used to hiss him from the side of the stage. I used to go, you're a bad actor. You can't act. You're all personality, charm, no technique, no technique. He loved this.
And he gave you the ring?
Well, this became a thing in the language. I used to say, and he would say, instead of good morning, you know. And he gave me this ring with a double S on it.
What about Ivor Novello and Noel Coward? Were they rivals?
Oh, no, they both worked really completely differently. You see, to me, Ivor was a workman and Noel was a genius. Therefore, if Noel got something wrong, he couldn't put it right. If I've got something wrong, he'd go on working till he got it right. I'm not comparing them as, you know, right playwrights and so forth, but there is one really funny story I must tell you if I remember it. See, when Noel wrote his big show for Drury Lane, which was called Cavalcade, a great big jingoistic patriotic affair, you know, Ivor was in America. And it was an enormous success, of course, and all this news dashed through to America, and Ivor heard it and was very delighted, of course. And he came back, and in those days, things had been done rather differently. As soon as he's both Mauritania, whatever it was, arrived at Southampton, there was a fast car waiting on the jetty to whisk him to London so he could be in the box with a party of friends at Drury Lane at 8 o'clock to see the curtain go up on Cavalcade. Well, he did this, and of course, he was a wonderful audience. He laughed, he screamed, he fell about, he cried, he sobbed, he jumped around, he clapped, and went back to his flat very, very excitedly. And this time, Noel was on the way to America in the other one. The Aquitania or the Queen Mary or something like that, you see. So he got back to the flat and he sent a cable to Noel, who was still mid-Atlantic, and all it said was, quite frankly, Noel Coward, don't be silly, dear, of course you can walk on the water. Love, Ivor.
What a wonderful end to our interview. Barry Sinclair, thank you very much
Not
indeed.
At all. Pleasure.